Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. In today's video, we continue with the series I'm doing about MLOps, LLMOps. In this case, we are gonna do a fine tune of an LLM and also create an inference endpoint. We will fine tune a model for document classification, and we will do everything using the framework MLflow for logging all the activity and track the experiment, and also to log models and experiments into this infrastructure. As usual, I have created a notebook which I will later on upload to the repository with all the materials to you replicate the what you are gonna see on this notebook. And we did already, we had done a lot of stuff of how to use different use cases, different scenarios of how to use MLflow. In connection specifically with this project, which is something I'm doing as part of my daily job, is a replica of a project I'm working on. I've been working on this for the past 7-8 months, and then on previously, and you had already a video on the channel where I explain how to deploy the MLflow infrastructure, the tracking server, into Docker containers. I patch you here the video in English and also the connection to the code and to the materials in the repository, and also I already upload a video how to create and fine-tune a LLM for the text classification. In this case, I'm using the Classifier, and you already have all this material as well, the video in YouTube and also the code in the repository. You can take a look here in the repo, the MLflow. We had a section already in the repo where I cover practically all the stuff I had been done for the past MLflow infrastructure was done 6 months ago, and the T5 stuff was done. T5 is in a folder with the name T5. I did a couple of videos, one using the T5 for sequence classification, which is the solution I finally use, where I only take the encoder, and in top of the encoder we put a linear layer to finally do the classification of the tests that we pass through the encoder of the artified, and this is kind of a conventional classifier, and then we provide to the user a score, a label with the probability, with each probability. The second option we have is sequence classification, which is the conventional way of work of the T5 architecture, where we use the transformer without encoder decoder. So we use the input, we use the encoder, and then on the encoder feed as well the decoder. And here, instead to have a class, numerical class with the probabilities, we have a prediction, we generate a label. This is the way how it works, the T5 for conditional generation. And well, you have both examples, but finally what I implemented for this project is the T5, sorry, is the T5 for sequence classification. Okay, so I recommend you, I strongly recommend you to you review these two previous videos if you want to understand this one, because I will oversee many of these stats. I give it like done. I will not cover in today's video these two, how we do the fine tuning, all the steps. Just simply, we will focus on the REST API, on the dockers, how we create the dockers, how we create the compose, and also the CI pipeline in Azure DevOps. So this is a high-level design of the classifier. My mandate was to create a classifier, document classifier, for an arbitrary number of classes. The user can decide they want to create a classifier with 10, 5, 7 classes according to their requirements. And then on the way that I organize this is just I request just the user to prepare the documents that we will use to fine-tune the model in organizing folders, and every folder has to be named with the class name, and inside of the folder with each class name a minimum of 100 documents. I also expect to have TXT files on these folders, and then on apart of that, this is the only requirement. You need to understand, here you probably will see better, this is the workflow of the custom classifier. So I had a UI. The UI is this is a tool essentially which is doing which is scanning the file system, the network share, a data lake, and then on it's extracting information from the files you have on your data lake. This information is either classified, like in this case the documents, versus an arbitrary classification that you decide. For that reason, we create a custom classifier, and then once we fine-tune the classifier, we save it in the model repository of MLflow, and then on you can use this classifier after fine-tuning to classify at the moment is only one by one the classification. The idea is to extend this to classification in batches, no? So you send a number of the files and you want to receive a classification of every individual file. Secondly, you can train as much as classifiers you want. It's not there is no limit, and the only that we demand is just to provide the files to fine tune the classifier. So in an initial request, the request that is done in our case from our UI, we just receive a request via POST with the labels, the data path, so the route where is essentially the root of the folders. These folders had to match with the labels that or at least is the labels that you send here as a list of the strings had to be included into it had to exist a folder under this root path with a folder with the name of the label, and inside this folder it has to be at least 100 txt files that represent that class, and also an experiment name to later on this is to housekeeping to organize the experiments in MLflow. We don't provide the UI of the MLflow to the user. We just simply ask to provide a name. I have created some entry points to do housekeeping of the MLflow, to delete experiment, to delete runs, and to visualize as well the latest runs, the status of a specific run or a specific environment, specific run, but we don't provide access to the user, to the final user. The user interact with the UI of the product, and then through the UI we interact with the entry points that I will show you in some minutes. The user interact with the entry point I expose in the API I have created in as front of the custom classifier. So once you book a classification process, a fine-tuning, the front, there is an application here, the API receive the request. Essentially, this is done with fast API, it's running in a Docker, and then there is some logic to create the dataset. We are using the transformers to do this. We use the dataset and dictionary dataset classes in transformers to create the datasets, and then once the dataset, we do some controls, some checks to verify that we have enough information to fine-tune the model. Then we create the trainer, and then we fine-tune the model. We also had the parameters of the trainings are for the moment a configuration that only the technical side can modify. We take these parameters from dictionary, from a JSON file, but it's not allowed for the moment to modify this for the final user. The plan. So the idea is the user, the role of the user is just book a fine-tuning, and later use one of the classifiers that they have created. So the parameters are fixed for the moment. We can change it. We'll see release how we will manage this scenario. For the time being, they are fixed. No, there is a number of features that I need to implement, but the current status is like this. The training parameters or the fine-tuning parameters are fixed. I'm using as well transformers for the fine-tuning, and again, as a base, we use the T5 base, which is a model which is more than enough to do this. As you can see at the beginning, I do tests with Mistral, Llama 2, but they are too big and too much for the purpose of solving the use case I'm working on. It's more than enough with a T5, even with a bare case model, is more than enough for a document classification. Also, using a model with this size, we are able to even to move the training to a CPU without the need to use a GPU. It's still a reasonable time to train a model without the need to use a GPU. Obviously, there is a increase on the time of doing the fine-tuning, but at the same time, there is a reduction in the cost of the global cost of doing this activity, this task. So once the training is done, we return to the user the all the metadata that MLflow produced for that run, and we save it in a small database which is accessed by the UI. Then on the user is can start doing predictions. As I said, from the time being is only one by one. And then on what they do is just send a text or a document, text or a document to a specific run ID, and then on this is received as well in an entry point. For the moment, all the entry points are in the same application. This is as well some plans to split the Docker, in this case, or the infrastructure which is doing the training from the infrastructure that is doing the inference. Everything is, as I said, leveraged by MLflow, so we can split this very easily, even without too much effort. So it's one of the things that are in plan. But for the moment, everything is on the same Docker, and then we send a request with the test and a run ID, and then on we return a prediction. I can give you, for example, here I think I have a prediction. You can see here how this really works. No, we just send. I will show you how it looks like this on QA, and you can. It's essentially we send a run ID. This run ID on the UI is extracted from the table. We map this run IDs with the experiment name and with some other metadata that we extract from the fine tune. Still, I don't have here logs from the previous one, but well. Essentially, as I said, at prediction time, you just simply send this and you get a code. Well, this is the status of your request, the data. This is a binary classifier, simply binary classifier with CV or non-CV, and the prediction score, etc. And this is also metadata for the application. No? What more? Okay, so I will pass you here. We are going to cover now the different components on the infrastructure and how to create the different dockers. The infrastructure is let me one second. I will prepare it in a second. One second. I'm just starting in local to show how the components we have in this application. We had the five components, the classifier itself, the database. This is the tracking server where we have all the metadata of our experiments in MLflow. The MLflow itself, the front of the MLflow, which is connecting, as I said, you can check in here. We connect, this is MLflow, the tracking API, what we expose, and then on the tracking API and the tracking server. And then the tracking server had an artifact store. That artifact store essentially is just a pointer to a folder, a volume that is mapped to the Docker where we deposit all the artifacts, and especially the artifacts. And then on the database is being used here. This is the MariaDB, where we keep all the metadata of our experiments, and then you know, to manage the database we have another Docker which essentially is just a Docker with a tool to do administration, php my admin. So here you can take a look to the logs we had as well. All the stuff is running. You can go to every individual Docker. This is working in local, in production, or in QA. The stat I will show you is production. In local, well, my machine is not how to say powerful enough to be able to run all this stuff, and then I will show you how it works in QA. But again, we had these five components. The latest one is the nginx, which is a reverse proxy to expose to the public and to rename the IP address semicolon port to a folder in the root directory of the application. So again, we had the database for the metadata of our experiments, the fast API application with the logic to do fine tuning and the entry points to interact with the UI, the tracker, which is essentially the tracking server and the UI of the MLflow, PSP admin to manage the database, and our reverse proxy nginx. Okay, so let's go to the code. So this is how I organize the code. It's pretty simple. For those after watching the video how to build the MLflow infrastructure, you will be able to from that I only include the custom classifier service, which is the Docker with my API and the nginx. The rest is exactly the same. I recently include some logic to download the T-file just when the Docker is started to avoid doing that the first time that you book an experiment. This way, just we speed up a little bit the first experiment. So the rest, as I said, in the Docker Compose, we have our MariaDB, our database, the PSP admin, MLflow, with the different, how we are managed secrets as well, the volumes. I will patch you later on all this stuff to in the repo. You will be able to cover. And again, I recommend you strongly to watch the previous two videos if you want to fully understand what we are doing here. What more, for production, we already have production and QA. QA is done in a VM, in Azure, with the Azure Container Services, and production is done in K8, in Kubernetes, the Kubernetes is still moving from another VM that we had before into a K8 cluster how the services are working is not changing from what you see on the Docker Compose. Okay, to build, let's move to check only the Docker, the MLflow and the custom classifier have the Docker containers. So let's check this is the MLflow Docker. There is only some requirements. I just updated a couple of days ago the previous to the latest version of MLflow. I don't like to install the latest. I always keep one behind, but yeah, it's the previous, one of the latest, and I updated as well the schema or the database with a tool. So here the Docker container, we just pass via arguments. I pass you in the to build this Docker. You can see here, we just build. We pass the argument MLflow. In this case, I pass a user. It doesn't matter which one. It's just a simply the user which MLflow is gonna use internally into the Docker to run the application. It's a security good practice not to use root. So that's why I use my alias in as user, and this way internally the application is running with this user, especially here where we are keeping all the connections. This is the Docker which is finally connecting with the database, with everything, so it's better not to have this running under root. In general, it's a good practice to always use another user to run the applications, and probably it will be something that I will do as well from the API where it's already still running on root. But here, yeah, I will show you now how it's done, then on the file and the tag of the version and the scope. So here we just receive the argument. This is also managed in the application as an argument. Docker local compose local MLflow arguments. You can check here and yeah. Okay, where is this MLflow? We installed some tools and upgrade the Linux. This is an Ubuntu 22 with the Python 3.11. We simply install some libraries that, well, this is probably not needed here again. I just realized that it's duplicated. We here create the user. We create a user with a home directory. We put the home directory into the path. We define as a working the home directory of that user, and we copy the requirements, we install the requirements, we basically create the directory where it's gonna run the where the application should deposit by default all the artifacts. Then on later we will map this volume to this Docker in the Docker compose, and here we just provide some rights, define the user, exports the port, and run the MLflow server with the parameters which are pointing to the backend store, which is the database, artifact root, destination, artifact destination, and the host and the port. So this machine, when you say set at no serve artifacts, is because this is not the machine which physically is going to keep the artifacts internally, not in the Docker by default. This is for the MLflow. Here we can take a look as well to the custom classifier. The custom classifier is very similar. We pass as well the model, Hugging Face token. We pass this we set up the environment variables here. I need to remove this because I or include them as well on the arguments. Then we install as well the some tools and update the system, working there, install the requirements, download the model, expose the port of this API, and run Ubicon. This is fast API. We can take a look to the endpoint. We just import some of the code, and then we define the logger. We use the environmental variables. I need to do here some malabars to configure the environment depending where I am. If I'm working in Docker, if I'm working in local, in my Windows or System Linux, if I'm working in local but in Docker in Dockers, or if I'm working in another environment. That's why you here see a lot of getting variables from the environment and then on logging everything to be able to understand where I am. Then on here the application is working in a GPU or in a CPU. There is a parameter which allow us to move the training to the CPU, which is was one of the latest requirements I have, because and especially for the environments like test or QA, we don't want to spend money in servers that had a GPU attached. So we prefer to spend more time and where we are doing the tests and just remove this dependency. For production, we keep the GPU, but well, in order to do this change, I need to I had to do some changes as well on the code to allow the training to be done in CPU. There is still some enhancements I need to do, but for the time being, it's working. Here we define endpoints, test, health check, work status. This is how to check the status of the job in the application server, and this is to check the status of an experiment. So here we are just returning the status of the last three experiments, but according to the status in MLflow. Here is on the application server. This is done during the execution of the job. I'm modifying the status on the of this request, and this is what we can check with this entry point. And here, essentially, we just take the request and we query MLflow to understand what is the status of the latest three requests. Here we had via POST, here we had the same via GET. So in the via GET, and then the only thing that we send is the name of an experiment, and here the same, but here is done by POST. We get the attribute with this experiment name, and here these two entry points is essentially to verify or to check the latest three runs of this specific experiment in this case. So we just receive this as a parameter, and here just include it on the URL because this is a GET. Here we get all last runs. We can pass here. We just send a GET, and then you get at least all experiments that have been run on the platform. Here we do a soft delete of an experiment. You probably know that MLflow is only doing a soft delete for compliance reasons. So you cannot delete, the application is not designed to delete permanently the experiments, unless that it changed it recently. But at the moment I implemented this 6 months ago. Not 6 months ago. This part of the interacting with MLflow was implemented 3 months approximately ago, but at that time it was not allowed, and before as well, not allowed to delete the experiments or the runs permanently. So the only thing that is done is when you click on delete. Let me when you delete in MLflow. Let me show you. Mm-hmm. This is here, no, where I have this, here, exactly, MLflow, when you click here, delete, or you want to delete this, the only thing that happens is that you delete this from the UI. Later, if you check on the, let me log in here, 1 second, this I think I have it somewhere else. 1 second. So when you check on the database, for example, run, the only thing that you do when you are deleting on the UI is just changing the lifecycle stage from active to delete. So you will not see any more on the UI, but this doesn't mean that the information in the database or the information in the artifact repository is deleted. So here I received the requirement to implement a hard delete. This is what here I had before to go to the hard delete. I had the soft delete via post and via this is for an experiment, this is for a run, and here I had a hard delete. The hard delete is implemented, but most likely I will remove it because in my opinion is a huge exposition, a huge security risk to allow to do this. And then on most likely what I will do, it still maintain the requirement, especially for those environments, not for production, but for the environments that like QA or test, what I will do is to decouple this into a script which is running probably on the MLflow server, tracking server, and essentially it will be a Python script which connect to the database and remove permanently the entries of all experiments with the delete lifecycle status, and also at the same time take the run ID and delete the folders into the let me show you how it's. So this is the QA server, and then on in my case where I am, EWD, oops, I'm connected or not? Ah, come on. 1 second, it's not connected, this, no. 1 second, I will connect again. So I have it here, CD MLflow. So here is just simply, we map the Docker, a folder here, which is essentially also mapped to a file server, and then we have here that, and then once you have, you want to delete something permanently, the this is the custom classifier, and then here is running all the dockers. So here, what essentially have every Docker is mapping to some, depending on the need, it's been mapped to one of the folders. Well, the MLflow is mapped to this folder, and also the custom classifier. So when the idea probably will be to just implement a script either here in the host where it's running the Docker desktop and all the Dockers, or in the MLflow tracker, in the MLflow tracking server, which essentially will connect to the database and it will delete the these two Dockers, the database and custom classifier and MLflow are connected to this folder. They can read and write on the folder for experiments. So probably what I will do is create a script on one of these dockers, most likely on the MLflow tracking server. I'm working under the Chrome, run every day, once per day, and review which experiments are in, which runs are in remove status, and delete everything physically from the disks or also for the database. But again, just keep in mind that MLflow is not providing this by default. If you want to do something like that, you need to implement it separately. Here is the entry point process. The what you saw, this is just booking a fine tuning, and this process as well, it will lock the model into the MLflow. So when you book a process, a fine tuning, so every request contains three steps. One is prepare the data set, the other one is the fine tuning itself, and the latest is the validation. So the validation is done with part of the files that the user provide. The data set creation is just we read the folder that the user pass in the, let me show you this, I don't know, it's here. So you look at the request, we just pass the labels, the path, and the name of the experiment. So what this process is doing, we send it to the process, and once I receive the application, we read the folder, we create the dataset, we train the T-file or fine tune the T-file, and we do our validations. Once this validation is done, once the training is done, we save the model. In this case, let's check the metrics. You can see here 0.89. Well, this is just a test. And then on the model is saved here in the run, and we pass the run ID to the user, back to the user ID to be able to use it. It will retrieve the model directly from the run. We have the components, which is the tokenizer, the metadata, which is the model, all the metadata of our model, T5 for sequence classification, framework PyTorch, the type of data, the versions, etc., on the YAML, all the necessary to replicate this environment, the Python environment, same but with a requirement, transformers, stores, etc. And we had the model itself in transformers version. This is our save tensor, JSON, all the classes, and here just a replica of everything. So everything, this is the model car. As you can see, the MLflow is really, really model car data. It's really helping a lot to keep track of everything that you have done, model metrics, overview, and here we have parameters, metrics, and the description. So once you have this done, we do the validation. The validation as well is just, well, you can see here, precision, recall, for doing invalidation process and in artifacts, I think just a confusion metrics. So this is automatically done per every single process that the the user book. Recently, I moved. I implemented the possibility to do training on CPU. You can observe here. So this training I did 28 days ago. This is done in a CPU. This is a binary classifier. So previously, the same training take 3.1 minutes. And then on moving the process to a CPU take 23.4 minutes. If you take a look here with a classifier of 10 classes, it's essentially the same dataset training in GPU, training in a CPU. It's possible, as I said, but well, you need to pay the cost of the using more time, but obviously the price of a VM without a GPU is probably 5 times lower or 6 times lower per month, even less. I will say that the GPU without the T4 is costing $100, with the T4 1,200. So, well, it's a big cost. Essentially, when you have a lot of environments, a lot of applications running on CPU, your manager or the CFO will call you, well, what you are doing? We need to reduce costs. Well, I think that all of us know what I'm talking about. What more? Well, here we had the entry point. I will patch you this later, you can review. Then we have here the entry point for predict. It's the one that you saw before. And yeah, everything for the time being is in the same code base. My plan is to split at least physically into Docker training for from prediction. Probably we don't need to change even the code. We can deploy the same code. And then it's just a matter to name and to create different services into the Docker Compose, but we don't need to change the code if we want to split the training from the inference. Okay, so we cover the Docker, Docker files, custom classifier, MLflow, Docker Compose, as I mentioned, the explanation from the MLflow, you have it on the video. Here you have the custom classifier, and you have NGINX. The NGINX depends on the configuration here. Sorry, not one, in Docker's configuration. So essentially we are exposing the MLflow, custom classifier, and PHP admin. This is only done as a set on QA and test. The idea for production when it's fully deployed, we will remove these entry points or limit the IPs to which can access to these entry points. Not for everybody, just for maintenance or for or debugging purposes. Keep in mind that this service is offered in two modalities. One is you can deploy the scanners running in QA in your on-premises, so you place your own infrastructure and we just deploy this, and then on there is probably it's an agreement with the user how they want to do this, and The other possibility is to use to deploy it via SaaS, the software via SaaS, and in this case, this will keep only accessible through the IPs in our data center. It will be not possible. This when we offer this to via SaaS, we are connecting to the data lakes of the client via VPNs. So there is a component which is not part of the ML components, which is the connectors. These connectors essentially connect to data lakes or file servers and read the files on the client side. So there is no exposition for these entry points to the client side, also not to internet. And then when the deployment is done in the user side on premise, here is still a little bit open to the user how they want to access to these entry points. Finally, the pipeline. So here the pipeline is the building pipeline. We have configured that when we merge code into the development. Develop is our main in this case, and well, we just simply connect to the. Let me show you. I think it's not the latest version. This, where is this? One second. NAS cookbook. I ask here. So here, I Docker compose. Azure, exactly. So here, essentially, we trigger the event when we merge into develop, connect to the Docker registry, to the registry is ARC, it's an old, or ARS, Azure Registry Service. We have a registry where we keep all the images in Azure. Container Registry Service, it's an old CRS or ACR, Azure Contain Registry, Azure Containers Registry. So everything in there is with ending in this URL, is something internal to Azure. The patch of the Docker files, the images in the repository. We pass the Sonar Cloud for quality. The different stages. First of all, we pass the obviously we had the test on local. We still didn't implement the test on the building pipeline. It's one of the steps that the other colleagues need to implement, but I leave it to you as well from your side if you want to do. Here we just evaluating the quality of the software with Sonar Cloud. Here we just build the Docker and we push the Docker to the Docker registry. Here is the MLflow tracker and here the custom classifier. After the building pipeline, we had the deployment pipeline as well in Azure DevOps, and then on it's just taking running the this Docker compose in production, which is essentially pointing to the images in Azure. Azure the tech is our organization there. And yeah, it's pretty similar to the local one, but just pointing to the images in in the registry. This is essentially ready in our case for the for the SaaS service. For the on-premise service, change vary a little bit, especially the building pipelines. You need the technical services to deploy the tool and to configure, and then on once it's not a big stuff, it's not a big deal. So the only problem is that most of the clients which install on premises is because obviously most of them are governmental organizations. They don't allow to connect to internet, so we had to have everything in ready to go. We need, in some cases we need to build the images from scratch and not able to connect to the obviously to any registry, container registry. We need to install as well the KA clusters, all the infrastructure on the client side, and then on this process change a little bit. For the SaaS, as I said, because we manage the service, it's easy because we can connect to Azure, and then our backend rely on Azure services, and then on we can keep the images and automatize the processes of deployment. For the on-premise deployments, is as you can imagine, much more complicated, and they need to technical engineers to deploy the tool and to agree with the customer how it had to be done. And then, as I mentioned, some of this stuff is modified on the client side to adapt it to their specific needs. And I will show you here where I think I showed you before. So we use as well, like all of us, Postman to check. So once we have here, you can verify. Yeah, it's one of the processes. Yeah, it's relatively everything that you see here is working on. Let's check the logs as well. Custom classifier. It's not this. It should be this. Let me check where I'm pointing here. I think, exactly. So I cannot see it there because this what we are seeing here is working already in K8. So no, we will not see it on the QA. Which I probably need to change the URL to do the test. But well, as you can see here, the response times is quite good, 995 milliseconds. Is where we are just classifying versus a classifier, binary classifier. Is a classifier done or fine-tuned over a T5, so well, it's not bad in my opinion. So the process is has been long. As you can see, I started this the previous two videos when I was starting the process. MLflow, that was this is the MLflow operations, the Docker compose, where we create the infrastructure in Dockers. That was done 6 months ago. Then on we did the transformers. This was even previous, 7 months ago. I did this video as well. And then on this has been a big, a long process to integrate all the pieces with the UI, with the backend, for the on-premise product, for the SaaS service is a long process, believe me. No, it's not that easy. So one thing is when to show you how these components, how to fine tune a model, this is the beginning of the history, my friends. This is just really the beginning. There is a long process of integration, of engineering, up to you have a product which you can sell or you can use in your company. It doesn't matter. Well, it's obviously a little bit more complicated than the deployment of conventional software. We are using microservices. It's a long process from the idea, the conception of a feature or how you want to use a model, up to you have something ready to go, is a really long process. And then the modeling, with this the phases, when I was showing you the how to train the model, how to build the MLflow infrastructure, well, was done at the beginning. That was really the easiest part of the process. The rest, when we integrate with the other components of the application, and then we had to cover different scenarios for deploy automatically the applications, fine-tune the whole process, because this is only part of a long process. And well, okay, that's pretty much all. I think you find it interesting and useful, and if so, well, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel you did subscribe before, and all these kind of things. And thank you very much for watching the video up to this point, and see you soon. Thank you.